हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द ब्रेन केज पॉडकास्ट। दिस इज शान एंड आई एम हेयर विद केली मायर एंड वी आर हेयर जस्ट हैविंग अ कन्वर्सेशन जस्ट लाइक टू फ्रेंड्स हु लाइक टू डिस्कस अ टॉपिक अ बिट डीपली। सो या एंजॉय
दिस कोट और दिस सेइंग परसेप्शन इज रियलिटी। ओके, सो आई वांटेड टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज योर like how you understand it. Like there is perception. Okay, perception is how I perceive. How I perceive is through my senses, right? How like touch, hearing, how I see things. Okay, so this is basically perception.
Yes.
And then how I understand reality is how I'm decoding, like how my brain is decoding this perception and creating my reality.
Okay.
So this is my understanding. What's yours?
You're exactly right. But we have to remember that what you see and touch and experience is read differently than what I see and touch and experience. For example, if we're looking at the same person, a stranger on the street, and we look at this person and we see them, but our belief system starts to run programs for our perception. Let's say, I don't want to be stereotypical, but let's say there's a man on the street who has heavy tattoos all over his body. He's riding a motorcycle, big beard, leather jacket. You might see this man as a threat. You might think that you're in danger because your belief system is leading you to that perception. To me, because I have many friends like this, to me, I see somebody who is probably loving and caring and is watching out for other people, because that's my belief system. So we're looking at the very same person, but we're seeing two very different things.
All right, so there is a base reality, and on top of it, there is my reality and there is your reality. Like first, there is a base reality which is there, but we are not seeing that. You are saying this, right? We are seeing our own version of reality.
Yes. I say that reality doesn't even exist. What does exist is real life events. So we have a real life event, but how that event is seen from person to person to person creates the many different realities. Somebody who has...
There must be some base reality. Don't you think? Like there must be some base reality, and on top of it are, like which you talked about, that our conditioning creates a perception of that reality. Like I'm like, there is that example you used of a bearded man riding a motorcycle.
Yeah.
So there is a, like there is a reality, like what he actually is. Okay, first there is that,
but when
and then how yeah. I see it and then how you see it, there are two realities, and that is my reality and that is your reality. But there must be something, some truth about that person, who, like what actually he really is like.
But that's his reality. See, all that exists is different realities. So take me for example. Some people, okay, so I have tattoos. I ride a motorcycle. I have long hair. But I also am a substitute pastor in my church. I also play guitar in the church's praise band. So some people see me as that man that's riding a motorcycle, maybe a threat, but that's their reality. Some people see me as a pastor in the church. Maybe that's their reality. But their reality says more about them than it does about us.
Yes. And how their realities came into being is from past experiences. How they have, like, for example, they met three people who are like you, and three of them did something to them. Now they have created this perception that this kind of person does this, right?
Right. Yes, yes.
And what do you mean by life events create our reality? You said something about life events.
Things that are happening in life all around us. It's the people that we meet, the things that we experience, the things that we see and touch and taste. All of those things that are going on around us in our world, those are real life events. But how we perceive those events based on our belief system alters our perception and ultimately our story, because our story is what's going to So let's say there's somebody who experiences a traumatic event, whatever it might be. Two people, they experience the exact same thing. One person might say, oh, I'm a victim. I'm a victim. They did this to me. I'm a victim. The next person might say, I'm so blessed that I'm strong and able to get through this. I'm so blessed that I have the strength and the courage and the determination to get through this. Yeah. So there is the same event, but two different perceptions creating two different realities.
Okay, so we are constantly changing our perception of reality according to life events and how we perceive it. For example, I have had a perception of that bearded, tattooed people who ride bikes. I had a perception. But then I met someone like you. And then that kind of cognitive dissonance happened. Like, my perception didn't match to my reality.
Yep.
So what will happen then?
Okay, so
the reality will shift?
Yes. What happens is we have to understand our value system and our belief system. Our value system is not based on past experiences. Something we value is something that makes us feel fulfilled. So, for example, we can value love because when we experience love, we feel fulfilled. And it's not based on anything that happened in the past. Our belief system, however, is based on past experiences. All of those past experiences create our belief system, and our belief system will remain our beliefs until something contradicts that. So, for example, we can believe that love leads to pain because of our past experiences. We got a broken heart or whatever, and so we know that love equals pain. People like this have to be careful because they will intentionally avoid love, thinking that they're avoiding pain, but in doing so, they're leaving that value unfulfilled.
Okay, so like values, so from where values come? Value do not come from past.
No, values are just, they're beliefs, but they're not based on a past. Values are attributes that we value in ourselves and in other people. Now, it doesn't, trustworthy. I value trustworthy people. Now, in my experience, I might not have ever met somebody who can be trustworthy, but yet that's something that I value in people.
Okay, so what I value, I look for it in the world. Suppose I value love, so I look for love in the world, or something like that.
Yeah.
How it will influence my reality, my values.
So ideally, you want to get your belief system to be closer to your value system, because then your beliefs, the things that you're moving towards, are more aligned to the things that fulfill you. And in doing so, that will alter your perception, which then changes your reality.
Okay. Interesting.
Lots to think about.
Yeah, it's like this. When I heard this, perception is reality, I thought I understood it. The more I think about it, it gets more and more complicated.
Another way to maybe approach it is as an example. Let's say that I tell myself that I can't go outside and do a backflip. Now, in my younger years, I could go outside and do a backflip, but right now, I can't go outside and do a backflip. That is my belief, but it's only a perception. Because the reality is that I can go outside right now and try to do a backflip.
You might do it.
I might do it, right. I don't know because I can't do a backflip. That's my belief. But really what's happening is that it's not that I can't, it's that I choose not to. Once you believe then that you choose instead of can't, I choose not to go do a backflip. Once you realize that, that changes your perception. Because when you realize that you're choosing, you understand that you can, or you can try.
Yeah, it's a how can we differentiate between like what belief is real? Like what, like for example, you might not be able to do a backflip, right?
Right.
And then your belief will be real. So how can we differentiate between a self-limiting belief and a belief which is real? Like which is based on truth.
Right. So the beliefs, remember that beliefs are based on past experiences. Our self-limiting beliefs are beliefs and they're based on our past experiences, but they're also beliefs that are holding us back somehow. Let me show you an experiment. I'm going to have you stand up. I'm going to ask you to twist, but I want you to twist only from your hips, not from your knees, not from your ankles, just from your waist, okay? Hold out your right hand straight in front of you. Now, I want you to twist to your right from just your waist as far as you can. Now, I want you to point at something as far as you can.
All right.
Okay, point at it, look at it. Now, come back. Come back to me. Now, put your arms down. And I want you to think about something for a moment. Do you remember when you were a little boy and you were with your friends and you would throw rocks and see how far you could throw the rocks? And every time you threw a rock, you threw it just a little bit further. And you'd pick up another rock, this little boy, and you'd throw it and it would go just a little bit further and a little bit further and a little bit further. And your friends couldn't believe how you were throwing these rocks so far. But every rock you threw, you threw it just a little bit further. Now it's the same turning around. Imagine yourself right now turning all the way around like an owl and facing me in front again. That would be crazy. Don't do it yet. Don't do it yet. That would be crazy. I want you to imagine that happening in your mind. I want you to see yourself turning all the way around like an owl and pointing straight back at me again. That would be weird. And we'd put that on YouTube and that would get a lot of views. That would worry me just a little bit. But you could see yourself, right? Twisting all the way around. Yeah. Even your headphone cords are going to get tight because you're twisting so far.
Yes.
Okay, so now I want you to do this again. Hold your hand out in front of you, just like you did last time.
Yeah.
Yes. Turn to your right again. Go as far as you can. Even further than you did before, like that owl going all the way around. And point at what you're looking at. Did you go further?
Yeah, a lot further.
Okay, so my question for you, Sean, is why didn't you do that the first time? Because I told you to turn as far as you could, right?
So, yeah, how it happened? Like,
how did you turn? So
what was the mental? What was the mental process like? What exactly happened, according to you?
So what happened was the first time I asked you to churn, you churned as far as you believed that you could. But then you did a visualization. Visualization is powerful, and it changes your perception and it changes your reality, because the second time you did it, you went even further. Even though the first time I asked you to do it, you went as far as you could. So it was all about your belief system. You began to believe that you could turn further.
Yes. Okay.
Is that making sense?
Yeah, it makes sense. I'm curious, like, how many self-limiting beliefs do I have, which I am like having in my daily life, which are limiting me?
Okay, so what just happened is, when we started, you had a belief that you could turn so far, and you turned as far as you could. But then what happened is I changed your perception. And I was able to change your perception by getting you to visualize what was going to happen. If we can visualize and connect an emotion to it, like the excitement of throwing the rock and the craziness of being able to turn all the way around, if we can connect an emotion to the visualization, I can change your belief system.
If we can connect an emotion. Emotion is very necessary.
Emotion drives motion. Everything we do in our daily lives is driven by some kind of an emotion.
So the first time I was trying, I was not believing. Like, that was my belief, like, I will reach that much. Okay, and the second was, there was no emotional involvement. So if there was some emotional environment in my first time, then would I like move beyond my belief?
No, because you had a belief that you could turn that far. It doesn't matter how emotionally driven that belief is, the belief is going to be where your limit is. So wherever you believed, you could be very, very excited and ready to go. But if you believe you can only go this far, you're going to be very excited about going that far. But when I made you excited about going that far, then I was able to alter your belief and your perception to let you go a little bit further. The same is true with business, right? So in a business, if somebody opens up a restaurant, and you know that many new businesses don't succeed.
Yes.
So if they open up a restaurant and they're scared, they're like, oh, I'm not going to do very well. I'm not going to get a lot of people. I'm afraid this is going to not last as long as I want it to. Yeah. They're starting, that's their perception and that's their belief. Now, when they believe that, their whatever their belief is, they're going to put in that amount of action. And when they get that kind of results, that's going to change their perception. And as their perception keeps going down, their actions are going to also keep going down. The results are going to keep going down. Their beliefs are going to keep going down. And it just keeps going. The opposite is also true. Somebody opens up a restaurant and they can already see what their restaurant is going to look like in a year, and it's going to be thriving more than it's ever been. And they're super excited about what, I mean, they can even picture their office in the back of the restaurant. They can picture what's on the walls. They can picture all of these people at their tables enjoying their food, and they get that kind of an excitement. That perception is going to drive those actions, and those actions are going to give a different result. That result is going to push their belief system and their perceptions even higher, which is going to drive their actions even further. It's just like we did the turning exercise. You had a belief system, and from that belief system, your perception, you took appropriate action and you got that result. But when I was able to change your belief and your perception, you took a different action and got a different result.
We can also put it this way. As I observe, look back and observe myself, what I did, we are kind of brainwashed not to put 100% effort.
Like
when you said turn around, it didn't came in my mind like I have to turn around as much as I can. Obviously you pointed it out, but it didn't came in my mind like I can go more, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. When some pain arised, so I stopped. Okay, this is my limit.
Right.
So can we say, can we say there is always more?
There
how
is
much we try?
Yeah. I believe that the human potential is limitless. We can do whatever we want to do. I mean, think back in time. 100 years ago, would people ever believe that we could put somebody on the moon? Would people ever believe that, you know, we would be flying from continent to continent? You know, would people ever believe we would be driving self-driving cars?
Right.
But that belief system held back. But there was somebody who didn't have those limiting beliefs. There was somebody who believed that they could go more. And everybody thought they were crazy, right?
Yeah.
But they did it anyway.
So there was a difference in their thought process. Like suppose when the average person stops, so when the pain arises, when average person stops, okay. So was the difference was they didn't stop right then. They thought, okay, there must be more.
Yes.
Is it the case?
Yes. Roadblocks are always going to show up. If it's in the form of pain when you're churning, or if it's in pain of somebody telling you you can't do that, or if it's a roadblock of whatever obstacle you might hit, there's always a way around that obstacle. We can always choose failure. We can always stop. That's an option. But if we don't, if we keep going, if we find a way around that roadblock, we can keep going further and further and further.
Yeah. There's a great book which comes into mind, which I read last year. The book was from Ryan Holiday called The Obstacle is the Way. And
yeah.
So it moves in kind of the similar theme which you're talking about. It's a great book.
Yes.
Yeah. Great.
You're thinking about a lot of things.
Yeah. This is like very fascinating topic. And so back to when perception and reality.
Yeah.
Okay. So my perception didn't change. And my reality also didn't change. But something inside me shifted, which changed my perception. This is what happened as I understand it.
Yes, which then in turn changes your reality.
But reality is the same, right? Like nothing changed in my reality, just my reality, my subjective reality changed.
Yes, and that's what I mean by reality. The real life events didn't change.
Exactly, because some people might get a tone from this, okay, perception is reality. So when I change my perception, so something in reality will shift. No, your subjective reality will shift.
Yes. Which is what I call reality. The subjective reality is what I call reality. Because it is your reality.
That's the only reality I know. I haven't seen the base reality yet. And there is no hope, I think. You have given me again a lot to think about. We can wrap this up here, this topic.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad I gave you something to think about.